interesting because his father, although Arnold Hammer today is chairman of Occidental Petroleum Corporation, his father was Julius Hammer, who in 1919 was Secretary General of the Communist Party USA, which emphasizes the argument I make about my books, that at the top level, there's no difference between your top communist and your top capitalist, they interlink. You've got Arnold Hammer, chairman of Occidental Petroleum, his father was Secretary of the Communist Party USA in 1919.
So it's basically a power grab.
It's a power grab, an international power grab.
Now, during the Second World War, why Russia was pretty well decimated once again by German forces, what part did the American Unleashed program play in building up Russia's industrial capacity after the Second World War?
Well, Lend-Lease built up Russia's capacity, modernized it and expanded it during World War II. And there was some continuation all the way through perhaps to 1948, 1949. There was a program after Lend-Lease, which was supposed to be restricted to foodstuffs and industrial materials, but in effect, I checked the records in the warehouses in Super Maryland, I find that even after World War II, and this was against the intent of Congress, I suspect, there was a massive transfer of the latest industrial equipment to the Soviet Union under the so-called Lend-Lease program.
Now, in 1948, there was a fascinating book came out by Major Racy Jordan, in which he talked about American aid to the communists as far as their ability to build nuclear weapons. Did you ever have an opportunity of verifying the facts that we had given them the heavy water, we'd give them the wherewithal to build their atomic weapons?
Well, as part of the work I was doing at Stanford, I did investigate the shipping documents for Lend-Lease, and I took a sample of these documents, and I checked them against Major Jordan. And broadly, Major Jordan was correct within, say, about 5%. And Major Jordan, of course, made the charge that we had shipped materials to the Soviets, 1944, 1945, which were later used in their atomic program. There is no doubt he is correct. We shipped heavy water, which is essential, but we shipped other items which are perhaps less obvious to the layman. We shipped, for example, aluminum tubes, and aluminum tubes are essential for atomic energy development. We shipped graphite, and graphite is another essential component. So generally, as far as I could check, and I checked the original government Lend-Lease document, General Major Jordan was correct.
Now, as the years have gone by, of course, we see a growing Soviet nuclear threat. The Soviets now have MIRV missiles. Mm-hmm. Can you get a little of the background on how the Soviet Union, which really didn't have the technology to develop those MIRV missiles that threaten our cities today, how were they able to develop the MIRV capacity?
Well, you've got to go back and look at how the Russians were able to develop a rocket, space technology anyway. What they did after World War II was American forces were held back for a while the Soviets occupied East Germany. They stripped East Germany. They took back the latest of the V-2 rocket technology from Peenemünde and other places. And the V-2 became the basis of the Russian space technology. Now, if you skip the intervening years, you will find when you come to the early 1970s that the Russians did not have the capability to MIRV their missiles. And in particular, they lacked the ability to produce the very precision, micro-miniature ball bearings that are needed for the control systems. There was only one company in the world, Bryant, Chuck and Grinder, which could make the machinery which machines the races which within which these ball bearings run. And without those races, you just cannot make MIRV missiles in any quantity. You can make one off, but not in quantity. Bryant, Chuck and Grinder was allowed to ship to the Soviet Union 45 of these machines at a time when we only had 33 in the United States.
But wasn't there any objection to doing this?
I objected at Miami Beach in 1972. Other people objected, but the objections were squashed. And predominantly at fault here is Henry Kissinger and the incoming administration, the incoming Nixon administration. This was known, I'm sure it was known in DOD. If I knew it, then certainly DOD knew it. But the objections were squashed, and there was suppression of the information.
And so once again we see America building up the military capacity, the nuclear threat from the Soviet Union.
Well, this goes, you know, when you talk about MIRVing of missiles, you're talking about a quantum jump in your military technology. Now, I'm not a military man, but to me, the ability to do that is a massive leap forward. And we enabled them to do it, and we did it knowingly and deliberately.
During the Vietnamese War, the Soviet Union and the Eastern European satellites were the primary suppliers of war materials to the North Vietnamese who were killing American boys in South Vietnam. Would you comment on our aid and trade with the Soviet Union and with the Eastern European satellites during that period of time?
Well, there's no question that the Soviets were the prime suppliers of military equipment and supplies to the North Vietnamese. Let me give you an example. The American pilots, as they flew over the Ho Chi Minh Trail, described the trucks that they were seeing as American trucks. Well, they were American trucks because they came from the Gorky plant, and Gorky was built by Henry Ford. And so you have the situation where we were, in effect, supplying both sides in the Vietnamese War.
But the trucks were being built by the Soviet Union. However, were they getting any materials from the United States to help build those trucks?
Yes, in the early 1970s, I know specifically of shipments of equipment into the Gorky plant while the war was going on, which in effect were aiding the Soviets to build more trucks to be used by the North Vietnamese.
How about loans? Was America extending loans to the Soviet Union during this period when they were the primary financiers of the North Vietnamese?
Yes. Beginning about 1970, there was a massive grant of loans to the Soviet Union. I'd say by about 1976, it must have totaled perhaps $40 billion outstanding. And so this, of course, these loans were used to enable the Soviet Union to purchase industrial equipment in the United States, and this industrial equipment was used to manufacture, in part, military supplies which were used against us in Vietnam.
How about Russian shipping that was being used to ferry supplies to North Vietnam?
Shipping is a very interesting example because the Soviets published a shipping register, about 6,000 ships, and I analyzed every one of these ships, both the origin of the technology of the ship itself, the hull, and the engine. Most of them are marine diesel engines. And I find that 60% of the Soviet merchant marine, which of course has military usefulness, 60% was built aboard. Only 40% in the Soviet Union, and that largely to Western design. But when you come to marine diesel engines, you find something really fascinating. You find that 80% of the marine diesel engines in Soviet merchant ships are Western engines, Burmeister and Wain of Copenhagen, Sulzer of Switzerland, Fiat of Italy, because that name has come up before. But the other 20% of marine diesel engines built in the Soviet Union are built to Western design under technical assistance contracts from Sulzer and Burmeister and Wain. So in effect, there could be no Soviet merchant marine without assistance from the West.
How about the building of the Kama River plant?
Kama River was built in the late 1960s, early 1970s. The basic design, the contract, was let to the Italian firm of Fiat. Giovanni Agnelli is the chairman of the board. And this is important because Agnelli is tied in with Chase Manhattan Bank. He's on the International Advisory Committee of Chase Manhattan. What caught my attention was that Fiat does not manufacture automobile manufacturing equipment. All the Fiat plants in Italy contain American equipment. And what I found was that the equipment was coming, perhaps about 60-70% of it, from the United States, from major automobile equipment suppliers in the United States. I think it was known as the Fiat plant as a cover to perhaps divert attention from the fact that during the Vietnamese War, we were building the largest plant in the world. It covers 36 square miles. We were building for the Soviets, with American equipment, the largest plant in the world. And so it was called the Italian Fiat plant, and I think this was a blind.
And so they were building their trucks and armored personnel carriers and other things that could be used then for warfare in South Vietnam?
We knew that the Kama plant had military potential. In 1972, I wrote it in National Suicide. I said as much in Miami Beach in 1972. This plant has military potential. It can produce military vehicles. We knew it. And of course, today in Afghanistan, we find that the Kama vehicles that are there in Afghanistan today from the Kama plant built by American and Italian companies.
And it was after